Welcome back to Unit 9 of Chemistry Matters. By now, you've created models that demonstrate the relationship between pressure and volume in gases. So let's go back to our classroom, where we've mixed up some of our students, but they're ready with the models our teacher asked the students to make in the last video on the Unit 9 playlist. You can see how your models compare to the models created by our students.
Who'd like to show their model first?
We will. We made a model of the marshmallow. There are little air bubbles in a marshmallow, so when the vacuum gets turned on and air gets sucked out, the air bubbles expand. As they expand, it makes the marshmallow expand.
That's a good description. Another way to think of it is that when there isn't as much external air pressure pushing on the surface of the marshmallow, the air bubbles inside the marshmallow can expand. How about you two, Dory and Colin? Can you describe your molecular model?
We explained the balloon kind of like the other team did. Without a vacuum, there's equal pressure inside and outside the balloon.
Yeah, it's kind of like a shoving match between the air outside and inside of the balloon. When the vacuum's turned on, the outside air is removed, but the inside air is trapped inside the balloon.
So the air molecules inside the balloon push out against the balloon and the balloon expands.
Great explanation. You all did well making models to illustrate the relationship between pressure and volume, as described by the ideal gas law. Let's look at another relationship in the ideal gas law. If we increase the temperature of a gas, what will happen to the volume? Caleb, what do you think?
Well, looking at the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT, temperature is on one side and volume is on the other side, so they're directly related.
So you're saying if temperature increases, volume will increase?
Yes.
All right, let's see what happens. This demonstration will explore the relationship between temperature and volume of a gas. Everyone, put on your safety goggles. I have in front of me an Erlenmeyer flask containing about 25 milliliters of water on a hot plate with a balloon over the opening. We'll heat the flask of water to boiling and see what happens to the balloon.
The balloon's inflating. Why is it doing that?
It has to be the water vapor.
Let's stop this lab before the balloon pops. Does this demonstration confirm your prediction?
Yeah. When the temperature goes up, the volume definitely increases.
So, what's going to happen when we cool down the water vapor in this flask?
I think the balloon will shrink.
Okay. Let's see what happens when I put this Erlenmeyer flask into this ice-cold water.
I was right. The balloon is definitely shrinking.
Exactly. Let's leave it in there a little longer. What do you think will happen?
When the temperature goes down, the volume will get even smaller, right?
Good prediction. Let's see.
That was amazing.
Yes, it was. And depending on conditions, sometimes the balloon will even collapse right into the flask. Does anyone know why that would happen?
It must be because the temperature of the gas changes so much because of the cold temperature of the ice water.
Yeah. So the volume of the gases in the balloon shrunk even more.
I think you figured out a significant characteristic of gas behavior. When gases are cooled, the volume they occupy always gets smaller.
So, when temperature increases, volume increases, and when temperature goes down, the volume goes down too?
Exactly. Who thinks they can explain what we just observed at a molecular level?
I'll try. The kinetic and molecular theory says that kinetic energy and absolute temperature are directly related.
So lower temperature means lower kinetic energy. But I'm not sure how that relates to volume.
I think I get it. Slower moving molecules will have fewer collisions with the balloon. Will that cause the volume to decrease?
Yes, it will. Great teamwork. Remember that gas pressure is caused by collisions of gas particles against a surface. If the particles are moving more slowly, they'll collide less frequently against the balloon. and the lower pressure inside the balloon will cause the balloon to deflate.
I hope the demonstrations our students just performed gave you a better understanding of the unique behavior of gases. These behaviors can be predicted using the ideal gas law and can be explained on a molecular level with the kinetic molecular theory. If you want more information about how to conduct the balloon demonstration our teacher just showed us, you can find instructions in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. Now that we've investigated the rates of reactions and the behavior of gases, you're ready to challenge yourself. Let's apply what we've learned to understand a real-life problem. We have an engineering design challenge for you that uses your new knowledge about the rates of reaction and about the behavior of gases. We're going to develop our own airbags. And detailed instructions for this activity can be found in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. The use of airbags in automobiles has reduced serious head injury from accidents by 85%. The concept of airbags was discovered back in the 1950s, but wasn't actually used in automobiles for another 30 years due to the complex requirements for a successful airbag. An airbag must inflate to just the right volume and pressure within 40 milliseconds following impact in order to provide protection during an automobile accident. And the gas produced must be harmless both to people and the atmosphere. So scientists not only had to identify a safe, gas-producing reaction, but also had to optimize the rate of the reaction, as well as the pressure and volume of the gas produced. It's no wonder that it took scientists a few decades to identify and optimize our current airbag system. Airbags save many lives each year, but the chemicals used to generate the gas that fills the airbag are toxic until they react. We're going to investigate the suitability of an alternate chemical reaction for use in an airbag so that we don't have to handle toxic chemicals. Acetic acid reacts with sodium bicarbonate to produce carbon dioxide gas, water, and sodium acetate. These reactants are safe to use and easily obtained at a grocery store. Acetic acid is present in vinegar at a 5% concentration by mass. Sodium bicarbonate is simply baking soda. Your goal in this engineering design challenge will be to optimize the conditions for the chemical reaction between the acetic acid in vinegar and sodium bicarbonate so that a plastic bag is fully inflated as quickly as possible without rupturing. In order to do this, you'll need to measure the volume of the plastic bag and use that value to determine how much of each reactant you'll need to fill the bag with carbon dioxide. Let's head back to our classroom to learn more about our investigation of airbags.
We're ready to apply what you've learned about kinetics and gases to a real-life problem, designing airbags. We'll need to figure out how to determine the amount or moles of gas needed to fill the bag. Now, we can easily measure the volume of this plastic bag, but what's the relationship between volume and the amount of reactants we need?
I think I can answer that. The more volume of a gas you have, the more moles you have. More gases inflate a bigger bag.
That's right, Kayla. How do you know that?
Well, it just makes sense.
I think I know what you're asking. We just learned about the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT, and that has moles and volume in it.
That's exactly what I wanted you to think of, the ideal gas law. We haven't used the ideal gas law to do any calculations, but now we can.
But what values do you use for pressure and temperature?
Yeah, I wondered that too, and I don't know what number to use for R either.
Those are all good questions. Let's look at the ideal gas law again, one step at a time. This time, we'll be thinking of how to use it to calculate the amount of gas in moles. Let's start by dividing both sides of the equation by RT, so that we can isolate N, the number of moles. RT cancels out on the right side of the equation, leaving the equation expressed in terms of moles. N equals PV divided by RT. Since we're doing the experiment right here in our lab under normal everyday conditions, the value we'll use for pressure is simply atmospheric pressure, or one atmosphere. And the value we will use for temperature is room temperature, which is about 25 degrees Celsius or 298 Kelvin. Gas law calculations require that temperature be in Kelvin. R is called the universal gas constant and is equal to 0.08206 liters times atmospheres per moles times Kelvins. Just as a reminder, R serves as a proportionality constant, which is simply a multiplying factor that makes pressure times volume, P times V, equal to moles times temperature, N times T. This is a really handy number to use, but you don't have to worry about memorizing it. Now you have all the values you need to calculate the numbers of moles of gas for your airbag.
Colin? So do we plug the values you just gave us into the ideal gas law and solve for N moles?
That's right. Okay. The ideal gas law is a very common equation. Once you practice, it'll become familiar to you. Let's try to do a sample calculation now and see what we get for moles of gas. We'll pretend that the volume of the airbag is 500 milliliters. Take a few minutes to work with your partner and see what value you can calculate for moles of gas that this bag would hold. Okay, you've had a few minutes to do the calculations. Who would like to share the results?
I think I got it. I calculated that if the bag holds 500 milliliters, which is 0.5 liters, the number of moles of gas it would hold is 0.02.
That's right, well done. Can you describe how you arrived at that value?
Sure, we started with the ideal gas law, rearranged to solve for number of moles, just like we all did together a few minutes ago. Then we had to find the right values for pressure, volume, the gas constant, and temperature.
And we just talked about using normal room pressure and temperature. So those are the values we use. P equals 1 atmosphere for pressure and T equals 298 Kelvin for temperature.
You have to be careful to use the gas constant correctly so that all the units match and cancel out except for moles. The gas constant R is 0.08026. It has units of liters, atmospheres, over moles, Kelvin. According to this example, the bag holds 500 milliliters, which is the same as 0.5 liters. So that's the volume in liters.
So we just made sure that those were the values we use for pressure, volume, and temperature. We canceled out ATM on the top and ATM on the bottom. We also canceled units of liters and Kelvin, leaving moles as their remaining unit.
Then we did the math. In the numerator, 1 times 0.5 equals 0.5. In the denominator, we used the value for R, 0.08026 times 298 and got 23.9. Then we divided 0.5 by 23.9, which equals 0.02 moles of gas needed to fill this airbag.
Well done. I think we're ready to start the experiment.
Before our students begin this lab, let me remind you of a few things. We're going to investigate the suitability of an alternate chemical reaction for use in an airbag so that we don't have to handle toxic chemicals. Again, your goal is to optimize the conditions for the chemical reaction between the acetic acid in vinegar and sodium bicarbonate, so a plastic bag fully inflates as quickly as possible without rupturing. Begin by writing an experimental procedure, which must be approved by your teacher before starting your experiment. The procedure should include proper safety precautions, details on how to measure the volume of the bag, instructions on how to calculate the amount of baking soda and vinegar reactants needed, as well as moles of carbon dioxide needed to fill the bag, and an explanation of how your plan for timing how long it takes to fully inflate each bag. We'll assume that carbon dioxide gas behaves as an ideal gas, so that the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT, can be used. And of course, make sure that you prepare a data table to record relevant information during your experiment. And make sure you take certain precautions. For instance, be prepared for the possibility of your bag bursting, which can make a mess. Wear safety goggles and an apron. Carefully consider how you'll introduce the two reactants inside the plastic bag. The reaction occurs very quickly. It may be necessary to encapsulate the baking soda in a tissue so you have time to seal the bag before the reaction begins. No chemical reaction is 100% efficient. The reaction will likely produce less carbon dioxide than is calculated theoretically. Be prepared to adjust the amounts of reactants to compensate for less than 100% yield. Once again, we'll take a break in our unit playlist to give you time to write a procedure and prepare a data table for your experiment. When you're finished, come back and we'll compare your procedures with those of our students to make sure you're ready to begin this engineering design challenge.